فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
If you today go to young gangsters on the street and they see you, what do? Are you wearing a jilbab? The woman is fully covered and she's wearing a jilbab. What do they do? Huh? The kids on the street, the young kids on the street, they leave her. She's a Muslim, you leave her alone. Sah? She's holy, leave her alone. So they walk, they move, they stick on the wall, they leave her alone. They let her go past. If you go past the Asian little gangster kids, and you go against the Arab gangster kids, Somalian gangster kids, yeah? That's the same, they all do that. They respect the girl who's wearing a hijab, sah? But the woman, the minute they see she's wearing tight clothes and everything, they whistle, they call her, they go up to her, they ask her for her number, they shove her to the wall, they hug her, they throw themselves deliberately at her, on her, sah? Hello, ma'roof, no? We all know in school, sah? Secondary school. That's what they do. They pretend that they fell down, and he throws himself on her lap. Why? Because she's wearing that type of clothes that's calling the guys. But what the woman's doing is that she's saying, no, I'm doing this for myself. Why is it your pajamas like that? So, if you're doing this for yourself, and this is only for you, and it's been what means it, why is it when you go to sleep, you wear different clothes at night, and your pajamas is not like this? Sahih? Why is it you wear does a woman wear makeup at night before she goes to sleep? Does she fix her hair? Does she do in her nails? Does she do everything before she goes to sleep and say, I'm doing this for myself? Does she do that? Who is she fooling? She only does it the minute she told she's going to leave the house. Okay, give me a minute, a second. It's never a second, but they say that. They go up for 10, 15, 20 minutes, fixing themselves up. They come out, and now what she's paying attention. Is she doing this for every guy on the street? No, that's unjust to say. There's a group of men that she wants her to look at her. She's trying to attract. But what she doesn't realize is this is attracting even the ones that she doesn't want. It's attracting the ones she's not willing for. He's coming and saying, give me a number. She's like, no, I don't want you. I'm not doing this for you. And it's true because she isn't. She's doing it for Bakr here. But Zayd won't leave her. Zayd keeps coming around all day, throwing himself on her. But it's not you, Akhi. Just keep it moving. Are you with me, brothers? And this is a problem that's happening. So whether we lie to each other, or we fool each other, or we tell each other what we want to tell each other, the truth of the matter is, I don't believe that a woman that goes out and dresses the way she dresses, and she's doing it for herself. I don't believe that. For me, it doesn't soak into my head. And it doesn't go into my mind. With all justice, fairness, I know she's doing it for the opposite gender. She's doing it for somebody else. Because I can do tatabbur of that person's life. I can look at your biography. And I know when you go home, the minute you go home, you splash water over your face, your hair's all scruffy, you're running around not brushing your teeth, you wake up, you just, But then when the minute you want to leave, sharp. You can't then tell me that you're doing this for who? For yourself, and to bring yourself joy, and it makes you feel happy. It's not the case. ذلك أدنى أن يعرفنا. So this is what allows us to know the women who are chaste. But this is something I want you to realize. If a woman is not wearing hijab and she's dressed unmodestly, you can never call her a zaniya. Pay attention. This is what? You can never call her a sister just because she's not wearing a hijab. She could be wearing the most tightest of clothes. She could be dressing in the most un-Islamic clothing. Never are you allowed to refer to her as a zaniya. In Islamic court, you'll be lashed for that statement. You'd have to bring the evidence into what you accuse her of. All together. But what we do say is that clothing is not the clothing of a afifat. Women who are chaste. These are not the clothes of a chaste woman. These are the clothes of the prostitutes. Like the zunnat. Sahih? That's for you, sister. Allahu a'lam your situation. Are we together? Because there are other ayat which command us not to accuse, throw those statements. And nowadays, are those statements thrown at a woman just because of the clothes that she wears? Do you guys refer to her as a slut because she's wearing clothing? Do they say that, yes or no? Do Muslims even say that this woman is a slut because she's wearing this clothes? Do they not? This falls under what الَّذِينَ يَرْمُونَ Muhsanat, this woman could be from the Muhsanat. Throwing at those statements at her by saying she's a Zaniya is going against those Nusus. Are we all together? That's not your job and you're not allowed to do that. But the clothing that she's wearing and what she's put on is not the clothing of a Muslim. And it's not the clothing of a woman who is afif, according to Islam. According to Islam. ذَلِكَ أَدْنَا أَنْ يُعْرَفْنَا فَلَا يُؤْذَيْنَ. And then she's not harmed. We took the story, right? The Fusaq of Al-Madina. What would they do? They wouldn't harm the woman when she wears the hijab, صح? She would not be harmed and they would let her go. Now some sisters might say, but when I do wear the hijab, acid is thrown on my face, so can I take my hijab off? Huh? That doesn't change the ruling. Just because now when you wear it, you feel there is going to be attack on you, that then that means you should stay home more often. Stay home more often and abstain from walking around. And I think personally at a time like this, men, if a husband and wife don't have a license, both of them don't, the husband should first prioritize the license for the wife and facilitate that she has her car first. Okay? The reason is because of the society and where we're living. We're all together. I know it's not the most comfortable thing for your wife to drive you around. Oh, no, you turn sharp. That's mushkila, sir. But the reality of the matter is that the khayr in which it holds that the woman drives and what she can abstain from on the street is profound and it's great. Because the minute she walks out of that door, as she leaves, dressed the way that she's dressed, she is vulnerable and she's open to what? She's open to everything. So this is, if the women can do this, they should do it. Do make sure they get cars. ذَلِكَ أَدْنَا أَنْ يُعْرَفْنَا فَلَا يُؤْذَيْنَ. They won't be harmed, inshaAllah. وَكَانَ اللَّهُ أَنَّ اللَّهُ is غَفُورًا رَحِيمًا. One who is forgiving and one who is very merciful. Forgiving for any woman who was not wearing hijab before, who has done that sin by wearing clothing which is not appropriate for her and now has repented, Allah has forgiven. And Allah is merciful towards her. Whenever she repents from her sins, by wearing the hijab and the Islamic code, Islamic dressing that was set for her, Allah is there to take her repentance and give her what she wants. Shaykh al-Albani then says, فَفِي الْآيَةِ الْأُولَى, the first verse, it's in it, التصريح بوجوب ستر الزينة كلها. The first verse, it is clear and direct in the woman covering all of her beauty. وَعَدَمِ إِظْهَارِ شَيْءٍ مِنْهَا, and that she doesn't bring out to the open anything of it. أَمَامَ الْأَجَانِبِ, in front of foreign men, men who are not her maharim. Remember, we refer to men which are ajanib, are what? Men who are not her maharim. Meaning the men that we mentioned here are called her maharim. Those men that she is, that can see her aura, they are not the ajanib here. They are not the foreigners. So any, she can show her beauty. The first ayah is clear in the woman covering all of her beauty. He said, وَعَدَمِ إِظْهَارِ شَيْءٍ مِنْهَا, and that she does not bring out in the open any of her beauty, أَمَامَ الْأَجَانِبِ, in front of foreign men, إِلَّا except مَا ظَهَرَ, except that which becomes apparent. So Shaykh Albani here has to focus on this point now. The reason why he has to focus on the point which is إِلَّا مَا ظَهَرَ, except that which is apparent, we already mentioned how many views are regarding this. Two views. Hey, who held the first view up first? Albani held that view. No, what are the two views? First of all, who held those views? The first view was what?
The things that are apparent on the face and hands.
So the first view is that إِلَّا مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا, except that which is apparent, is referring to the face and the hands. Who said that view? Shaykh Albani is recent, like from the Salaf and the Mufassirin. Who said that? The ayah. Yeah? Abdullah ibn Abbas, hey? Abdullah ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab, hey? Yeah? Ikrima, hey? Ata ibn Abi Rabah, hey? Sa'id ibn Jubayr, hey? Bahak ibn Muzahim, hey? Abi Sha'tha, and it's also, Jazakillahu khairan, it's also the choice picked by Imam al-Badawi and who also? Ibn Jarir al-Tabari. That view says, إِلَّا مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا is referring to what? The face of the hand. The second view is what? Now, what's the second view?
The face.
Yeah?
The hand and the face have to be covered.
What's the إِلَّا مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا? The outer garment. It's referring to كَالْرِدَاءِ وَالْثِيَابِ. It's referring to the outer garment. Okay? Who held this view? Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. Who else? Hassan al-Basri. Who else? Muhammad ibn Sirin. Who else? Abu al-Jawza. And who else? Abu al-Jawza is the man who said, I neighbored with Ibn Abbas. 12 years I was neighbors with him. Abu al-Jawza. 12 years me and Ibn Abbas were neighbors. Every day I would take knowledge from him. The tafsir of the Quran, I took it all from him. 12 years next to the neighbor of Ibn Abbas. Ibn Abbas would benefit his neighbors as well. And those who were around him. That's the scholar. حَيْثُ مَا نَزَلْ. Wherever a scholar sits and is, he benefits those who are around him. Always see the benefits. The community, the neighbors. Huh? He benefits those who are around him. Even the kuffar in the local area know him. مَعْرُوفُ الْلَدَيْهِمْ. They point at him. Are we able to get a woman? My neighbor one time, she kicked her husband out of the house. She's a black woman. Her and her husband fought, boof, everything happened. So she tells him, leave. So at this time, you don't come to a neighbor, you don't interfere in their problem, you just let it be. So I just saw the guy getting kicked out of the house, taking his bag, you know, walking out. So I let Baptist take its course, I let everything happen smoothly. Then I came to the next day and said to her, is there a problem? What's happening? Is there something I can do to help you guys? And I was a fursa. This is a time when bad problems happen. You always can give what? Nasaih diniya, Islamic benefits you can give them. She said, now we got back together again. We're back together, everything's fine. So there was no place for me to come in. So a while later, one day I saw her, she had a problem with her car again. Another chance has come along. And the two neighbors on the two sides of our house, they were basically, they were helping each other. But they weren't doing the battery, the way they were connecting the... It wasn't right, basically. The plus and the minus weren't being done properly. Again, I saw this opportunity. I went in, rolled up my sleeves. I did what I could for them. I asked them what was the problem. She told me. I looked at it and said, I can honestly tell you, I don't know much about cars like that, I'm not. But one thing I can tell you is that it's nothing to do with battery. This is not a battery problem, something else. I think you should try to call the AA. So it ended up being right, I was right. And it was that, you know, these motorbike kids, they came and they basically opened her petrol tank, they took all her petrol. It's all her petrol, and what they did was the petrol tank right at the bottom of the car, they basically forgot to close it when they took the petrol out. So what happened was, whenever she put petrol in, it's going down from the bottom. So I just, I didn't know that much, but I told her this got nothing to do with battery. So then this opened a floor of discussion, and I said, look, yeah, have you ever... You know, it wasn't just have you ever, but it was leading to that. She could see it was leading to that. So she asked me about where do you work? I work in a masjid. I preach to people. I teach them about Islam. Have you ever looked into Islam? Have you read about it? Oh yeah, I have. And, you know, they just like talking general. But it's a fursa. You don't push yourself too much into the discussion. You just give them the idea. So tomorrow you can pick up from somewhere. And you can pick up. Muqaddim, that was the introduction. Tawtiya. Wa halumma jarra. So the person who is Ahlul Khair, a and who loves khair for the people, he believes he wants to save everybody from hellfire. He wants to benefit the community, the kafir, the non-Muslim, the everybody. You have your own household, you want to help them. Your own family members, your brothers, your sisters, your cousins, your relatives. You want to be a person who helps those who are around him. So this is what Al-Imam, there's a little kitab called Khud'a Aqidatak. Have you heard of that book? It's a little risale, inshallah. It's written by a sheikh called Sheikh Jamil Zainu. Sheikh Jamil Zainu, inshallah, we're going to study that book. Sheikh Jamil Zainu, he used to have sweets in his pockets. This is one good etiquette I advise you all to do. Is that just have sweets with you. Just carry it. Have it with you. Sometimes you come into contact with little kids. Just do that. He's an alim, man of knowledge. He has sweets. Kids come, they will never meet him with nothing in his hand. He'll always give them something. Yeah, sweets. He packs it and packages it for them nicely and just keeps giving it to them. What you don't realize is that I remember a man when we were young, we used to call him Adamina, which basically means Uncle Sweet, translation wise. But this man, he was a hardcore Sufi. He would always have sweets. And you know, my parents would never last take things from strangers. Regardless. So we liked the idea he would come and offer sweets, but we could never take it. So this is a good thing, good characteristics. Because that child, even when he grows up, when he sees you, his heart is in love with you. Anytime he sees you, he's ready for you to tell him what you want to tell him. So it's very important. I have a problem with my kids only like me because of sweets, and it's not a nice thing, man. Like my daughter, she's in the oven and that. My other kids in Egypt, when I call them, I say, "Dad, I'm coming, what should I get you guys?" Nana. Sweets, then I'll be sweets. It's a bit of a problem now because it's like, I'm only sweets, no other value. So, Sheikh Al-Bari, rahimahullah, he says, "Illa ma dhahara minha bighayri qasdin minhunna." Sheikh Al-Bari takes an opinion which is إِلَّا مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا هِيَ means, pay attention, is whatever becomes apparent from the woman without any intention. The woman is going and she's lifting, she's trying to grab something. Her arm shows from somewhere, or the hijab, it shows a part of her body. Sheikh Al-Bari has taken that opinion to be strong. He says, فَفِي الْآيَةِ الْأُولَى, the first ayah, التصريح, it is clear بوجوب ستر زينة كلها, that the woman has to cover all her beauty, وعدم إظهار شيء منها أمام الأجانب إلا ما ظهر بغير قصد منهن, without any intention behind it. So when her beauty shows, it's showing unintentionally. فلا يؤاخذن عليه, the woman will not be held account for that. فلا يؤاخذن عليه, the woman will not be held account for her beauty showing when she's not intending it. It's not intention. إِذَا بَادَرْنَا إِلَى سَتْرِي, if they hasten, إِذَا بَادَرْنَا, what is the word? بَادَرْنَا mean, if the woman hastens to covering her aura. Her aura shows, she covers it straight away. She just makes sure no one sees it. So this is what it means, Sheikh Nasir said. قال الحافظ ابن كثير في تفسيره. الباني رحمه الله, the now brings a statement of Ibn Kathir رحمه الله. Who is Ibn Kathir, and should we study a bit about who he is? So every person whose name is mentioned here, we'll just give a little tarjama, a little biography, mujaza of that individual, quick understanding of who that individual is. Who is حافظ ابن كثير رحمه الله? حافظ ابن كثير is المؤخر, المؤرخ, المفسر. Ibn Kathir is a historian. He was a great scholar of tafsir. His name is Ibaduddin Abu al-Fida Ismail ibn Umar ibn Kathir ibn Daw al-Qurashi al-Basrawi ثم الدمشقي. So his name is Ismail ibn Umar. His kunya is Abu al-Fida. His laqab, his nickname is Ibaduddin. Al-Imam ibn Kathir was born when the year was 701. 701 is when he was born. rahimahullah, and he moved to Dimashq when he was at the age with his brother Kamaluddin. Ibn Kathir moved from his place of birth to Dimashq with his brother Kamaluddin when the year was 707. This was after his father died, so he grew up as an orphan. Ibn Kathir rahimahullah. Ibn Kathir memorized the Quran when the year was 711. So how old would he be? He would be 10 years of age. And this is something common. Any talib ilm, any student of knowledge who wants to embark on seeking knowledge, what's the first thing that was always said about the Bible for the ulama? Hafidh al Quran. He memorized the Quran, وعمره, and his age was. You don't find a scholar being said he didn't memorize the Quran. The person who says to you, you don't have to memorize the Quran, is a person, and they want you to, and they're telling you to seek knowledge, is a person who is trying to waste your time. وقرأ القراءات, and he studied قراءات ابن كثير رحمه الله. وبرع في التفسير, and Ibn Kathir became elite in the science of tafsir. وحافظ, and he memorized, Ibn Kathir memorized the Kitab al-Tanbih. He learned the Kitab al-Tanbih from the top of his head. And he remembers the Kitab al-Tanbih. Abu Ishaq al-Shirazi wrote that Kitab, and he said, the Fiqh al-Shafi'i is a Shafi'i fiqh book. He memorized it. And this was the year 718. He learned Qira'at. So basically 7 years later, Ibn Kathir has now mastered Qira'at. He has mastered what? Tafsir. And is also memorized in Fiqh al-Shafi'i Kitab al-Tanbih. He also memorized in that same time Mukhtasar Ibn al-Hajib. And he also became a knowledgeable person on the hand of two scholars at that time. The first one being Burhanuddin al-Fazari, and the second one is Kamaluddin ibn Qadi Shuhba. Those were the two scholars in which he grounded himself from taking knowledge from them. And then what did he do? The hunger and the desire that he had for knowledge, he realized the only way to do this is to connect himself to the scholars and the people of knowledge. And he took it a step further, and what he did was he married the daughter of Abu Hajjaj al-Bizzi, Zainab. It was the daughter of Abu Hajjaj al-Bizzi. Ibn Kathir proposed to her, and he asked for her hand in marriage, and she was married off to Ibn Kathir. Who is Abu Hajjaj al-Bizzi? Abu Hajjaj al-Bizzi is the man that Ibn Taymiyyah used to read on sometimes, books of hadith. And Abu Hajjaj al-Bizzi is an imam, an alim, a scholar, profound, elite in what? In ilm al-hadith, the science of hadith. There's a book that the students of knowledge and the people who look into hadith, he wrote a book for them that they would never leave it. They will surround themselves, they will do i'tikaf on this book. And that book is what? Tahdhib al-Kamal fi ma'rifati asma'i al-rijal. That book, Tahdhib al-Kamal, Abu Hajjaj al-Bizzi wrote, is basically every single narrator in the six books of hadith, Bukhari, Muslim, Abi Dawud, Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, and Nasa'i, six books, right? So there's two Sahihain, Bukhari, Muslim, Abi Dawud, Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, and Nasa'i, six books, right? Any man in any of those books in the chain, if you want to see their biography, their integrity, who they were, where they were born, when they were born, who they took from, everything, you go to this kitab, Tahdhib al-Kamal, which is written by Abu Hajjaj al-Bizzi. Doesn't that tell you what he is then? And Ibn Kathir is now hungry for what? Hadith. He just studied Qira'at. He studied the Tafsir. He studied Fiqh al-Shafi'i. He's hungry for what? For Hadith. So he proposed to the daughter of Abu Hajjaj al-Bizzi, Zainab. He said, and remember that the person you marry is a representation of what you are. A sister brings to her father a guy whose trousers are sagging, and when he talks, he goes yo to the in-laws and the family. Are you with me? This is a representation of the woman the woman that the sorry a representation of the sister, the brother she's bringing. Are you with me, brothers? But if a sister brings a brother, taqi, talib ilm, student of knowledge, learning the deen, this is what she's saying, my mom, this is my mindset. This is how I think. This is my tadayyun, this is my religion. This is the person I think is compatible with me in terms of my deen. Are you with me? So this is important. So you can see what type of person he married and he went for. He asked for the hand of Al-Hajjaj al-Mizzi. And he married the daughter of Al-Hajjaj al-Mizzi, who was Zainab. That allowed him to stay close to his father-in-law. Stuck with his father-in-law. And he took from him. And he took a great portion of ilm from him, especially hadith. And because of Al-Hajjaj al-Mizzi, Ibn Kathir became a hafid in hadith. He reached a level called hafid. He also was in excessive love, as Ibn Hajar mentions in Kitab al-Durr al-Kamila. Ibn Hajar mentions that Ibn Kathir was in excessive love with who? Ibn Taymiyyah. Ibn Taymiyyah was alive at that time. Ibn Kathir would go to Ibn Taymiyyah's classes and he would listen to him. And Ibn Kathir was actually, he was harmed, he was criticized, he was even discredited by some of the scholars at that time, because he used to give the fatwa of the issue of talaq according to the view of Ibn Taymiyyah. Ibn Taymiyyah held the view that if a man says to his wife, you are divorced 3 times, and he said, talaqtuka thalathan, I divorce you 3, Ibn Taymiyyah used to say that that 3 is actually only 1. Ibn Taymiyyah held that view. And that view is against what? The 4 a'immatu arba'ah. Against the views of the 4 imams, Abu Hanifa, Al-Imam Malik, Al-Imam Shafi'i, Al-Imam Ahmad. And rather, this opinion is actually against the what? Jumhur ulama, the majority, the overwhelming majority of scholars. So, the people of Madhab are going to get angry now. So, and Ibn Taymiyyah, because of this issue, he got prison for it. He got what? He got prison for it. And some people would say to you sometimes, why are you going to cause, are you with me, brothers and sisters, pay attention? Why are you going to talk about fiqh issue, which is khilafi? Okay, stop talking about this, going to cause disunity. Masail, which were fiqhiyah, the ulama never used to dismiss it. Sahih? Ibn Taymiyyah didn't dismiss the issue of talaq. So masala fiqhiyah, he put his opinion forward strongly. And when Subki responded to Ibn Taymiyyah responded back to him. And you can see the rivalry between the two of them. Arabis and Masala, which is Fiqhiyya. Are we all together? Even Al-Imam Bukhari, right? You know Bukhari at the ending and the last stages of his life, what happened to him? Al-Imam Bukhari, he was accused of something he was free from, which was what? The Quran being created. They said that he believed that the Quran was created, and he did believe that. So Al-Imam al-Bukhari wrote a kitab called Khalq Af'al al-Ibad. He authored this book. This kitab, Khalq Af'al al-Ibad, Bukhari authored, he speaks, first part of the book, he speaks about what? The kufr of the Jahmiyya and the people who believe the Quran is created. And then after that, he goes into the issue of, did Allah create the action of the creation? Sahih, brothers? Are we all together? But I'm trying to get to a point here. Bukhari, rahimahullah, having gone through this issue, he felt loneliness. Bukhari felt alone. And one of the great scholars at the time who actually gave him a hard time was the great imam. He himself is an imam, just like Bukhari, is al-imam Yahya al-Duhari, rahimahullah. Al-imam al-Duhari, rahimahullah, is the one who's given a hard time to Bukhari. And he's an imam in his own way. He's an imam, just like Bukhari is an imam. But guess what? At that time, Bukhari going through the hardship, he was also shown harshness from the who? From the Hanafiya, the Ahnaf. Why? Because he authored not long ago a book called Al-Juz'u fi Raf' al-Yadayn, the raising of the hands, which is a fiqh issue. He authored that, he also became restrained because they benefited from this opportunity. They showed their hate and rage towards Bukhari at that time as well. So he felt ghareeb, he felt lonely, and because of it. And Al-Imam Ibn Kathir rahimahullah, because of the mas'ala to talaq, he went in tuhina, he was tested, bisabab dhalika wa udhiya, and he even became harmed. He really got harmed for it. Because he's a Shafi'i. So he's not meant to take the opinion of Ibn Taymiyyah according to the Shafi'iyya. So they harmed him. Ala kulli hal, he studied usul al-fiqh properly. And he listened and he took from Abi Nasr ibn Shirazi, Abi al-Qasim ibn Asakir, and many others he took from. He also turned towards memorization of hadith books. And he studied properly ma'rifatul ilal wal rijal wal tariq. He studied the defects of narrations. He also studied the biography of men. And of course, he's got his father-in-law, Abu al-Hajjaj al-Mizzi. He learned the chains of the hadith until he became an imam in that field itself. He also became grounded in what? In fiqh, which he previously knew, and tafsir, which he already knew, and nahw of grammar. Ibn Kathir was an imam in the language. If you look at his kitab, his book, his tafsir book, you'll see how he works on language and how he, mashallah, speaks about matters pertaining to the language. Ibn Kathir rahimahullah, many scholars praised him. And Imam al-Dhahabi, who's the teacher of Ibn Kathir, praised him. He what? He praised him. And he mentions that, or is mentioned in the Kitab al-Mu'jam al-Muhaddithin. Hafidh ibn Hajar in his Kitab al-Durra al-Kamila, fi a'yan al-mi'at al-thamina, he praised him in the first volume, page 445 to 446. Al-Imam Ibn Kathir's madhab was madhab al-Shafi'i. As I said before, he memorized the books of the Shafi'iyya, he studied the books of the Shafi'iyya, and the Shafi'iyya madhab was the common madhab of Bilad al-Sham wa Misr, Egypt and Sham, which is Jordan and Lebanon and Syria, and was Shafi'i madhab. If you look at Imam al-Subki rahimahullah in his Kitab Tabaqat al-Shafi'iyyah al-Kubra, if you read the first volume, page 326, he mentioned that no one would actually be a qadi, a judge, unless he studied with madhab al-Shafi'i. There was no other person. Egypt, that was the only person who could be a jurist. And the only person who could be a jurist in Sham was it was a Shafi'i. Ibn Kathir rahimahullah, many people just think he has this tafsir book. But no, he's got many other books other than that. He's got another book that does not go below the rank of the kitab, his tafsir book, which is his great book, Al-Bidayat wa Nihayat. The beginning to the end. He authored this book to start when the creation started and when the creation ends. But between after his death, somebody should come and add on to that, who knows history greatly, who can add it on, so the book can go more volumes, because each person is going to die somewhere. Another person can add on to it. It would be a great idea. He also has a Sharh of Sahih Bukhari that he always references in his tafsir book. But it's from the books that we lost. His Sharh of Sahih Bukhari is from the books that we've lost. Ibn Kathir died blind. He lost his eyesight. In his later stages of his life, he became what? He became blind. Rahimahullah rahmatan wasi'ah. And he died in Sha'ban when the year was 774. If you want to see his biography in more details, and you want to study his biography in more details, go to the Muqaddimah of the Tahqiq of the Kitab Al-Bidayah wal-Nihaya with the Ishraf of Abdullah Turki, first volume, page 32 to 33. Start from page 33. All of that is a biography of Ibn Kathir rahimahullah ta'ala. So Ibn Kathir, when his statement is told to you, you have an idea of who he is. I will try to do that to every imam who we mentioned. When we mentioned Ibn Jarir said this, who is Ibn Jarir? When we say Ibn Atiyah said this, who is Ibn Atiyah? Okay, so you have an idea of who you're dealing with and what weight and position does his statement really hold.